all of you as you've come and gathered for worship here this morning. And welcome also, of course, to those viewing this at home. May we all together know the blessing of God in our daily lives. Let us acknowledge that we meet on the land of the Kaurna people. The Ancient of Days breathed life into this land and her peoples. From time beyond our reckoning, the Kaurna people have blessed this place through their care and concern. We pay respects to their elders and leaders, past and present, and pray for the future of their communities. May we walk gently and respectfully on this land. These words of acknowledgement were made particularly relevant to me during this past week. Last Monday, I read the introduction to a new biography on Loitura Donohue by Stephen Rentall, a moving introduction. And then on Thursday, I locked into a national webinar program from Sydney, introduced by Dean Parkin, an Indigenous man, who's heading up a movement of encouraging Australians to think about the significance of the Uluru Statement from the heart. That was another inspiring moment. And I thought of how real these words are when we use them, beginning worship and beginning other events. Welcome again. I'm David Houston, your worship leader for the day. Our minister, Reverend Malcolm Rawlings, will bring us the message, continuing his October series. Rosemarie Vatta will bring the readings to us. And Murdoch is our music leader. Sharon Raju is managing the audiovisual desk. David is working that camera. And Carlo Harding is our technical support. Now, put the notices, will you refer to your grapevine and note the progress of nominations needed for Church Council. There are nomination forms available. I have one here. I'm looking at a number of faces and I'm coming your way. Think about your own possibility of contribution. Think of the contribution of somebody else and talk with them. And God will show you if either you or they might be part of this wonderful Church Council experience. So the forms are there. Any queries, speak to Ros and or other council members. The other significant thing that we wanted to do today and wanted to say today is to wish Delcy Holt a wonderful 90th birthday celebration. We think it's tomorrow. Is that right, Delcy? Tomorrow. Yes, it is. The family. Welcome to the family. Wonderful to see you here. And we remembered Delcy coming here about 20 years ago with Don on his retirement. And together they contributed a lot to the life of the church here. Delcy with her singing in the choir, lovely voice, and then her shared leadership in the fellowship groups and other activities. So you've lots of friends here today, Delcy, who are wishing you a wonderful time with your family as you celebrate this significant time. Pam and I knew Don and Delcy 65 years ago, I think, it all began, and it's been very much a and enjoyed shared friendship across the years. Our call to worship. We gather to rejoice in the grace and goodness of God. We come whether our faith is strong or weak. We come even when our prayers are faltering and our doubts rise. Because Jesus calls us to be with him, to be with him at this time and in this place. In his presence, we will experience healing, hope, and purpose for our lives. Let us now sing or reflect quietly together our first hymn. It's Together in Song 223, How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds in a Believer's Ear. Our prayers now. Prayers firstly, our praise and thanksgiving, and then our confessions. Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for who we are and what we can be. And although often hesitant in our discipleship, we know that Jesus is our shepherd, brother, and friend. You entrust to our human family the care of the whole creation. It is awe-inspiring and beautiful, and we live in a part of it that is full of wonder and joy. Inspire us to fulfill our role in caring for it. Thank you, God, for your truth that stays constant through all our changing circumstances, for the promised blessing that begins when we trust ourselves to the promises of Christ. Thank you for his grace that keeps our hopes alive through times of poverty, hardship, sorrow, and even persecution. And in this moment, we link ourselves with our Christian sisters and brothers who are experiencing these stresses beyond our imagining in this COVID virus time. We thank you for the gentleness, goodness, and mercy seen at work in the lives of those who trust you, and for the integrity and peace we can know within ourselves when we trust Jesus in this same way. Thank you for the faith that burns stronger as we love you with both our hearts and our minds. We praise you for the way we inspire each other, and that your presence is felt within our church family here and the wider fellowship we share with Christians far and near. We are lifted to higher ground in such fellowship. Jesus teaches us to be open to the blessing and strength you are so ready to give. Thank you for what we have received to this point of our life journeys. There is true praise in our hearts for all your goodness, O Lord. And this is our prayer this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. And our confession. Loving God, we confess to you the unrest of the world, of which we are a part, and even in small ways we contribute to. Forgive us that so many of us are indifferent to the needs of our fellow human beings. Forgive our discrimination against people of different race and colour and creed. Forgive us for our preoccupation with material standards. Forgive us as Christians for being so unsure of our good news in you, and so unready to tell it. Raise us, O Lord, to be a forgiven people. Let us hear then the good news. In the words of Timothy, Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, to forgive you in your failure, to accept you as you are, to set you free from evil's power, and to make you what you were meant to be. And we say together, thanks be to God. Amen.
Hi, how are you? Yes. It's good to have Mum there. I've got some cups, but we're not going to use them to drink out of. Have you ever tried making a tower out of cups and maybe putting another one on there and another one on there? And if I had one more, we could try up there. Do you reckon you could do that? Yeah? Okay. All right. Well, I'll put them over there. And we have to pick up one cup at a time and then put it there, and then pick up another cup and put it there, and another one and put it there, and another one and put it there, and another one. So you reckon you could do that? Okay. All right. You ready? Oh, just before we do it, you're not allowed to touch the cups with your hands. You have to use the rubber band and the string. So you're going to have some help. Okay? So, sorry, what was your name?
William.
William? William, would you like to stand up? Okay, you hold on to that one. Would you like to stand up? And we have another body?
Lachlan.
Lachlan, you want to come and hang on to one of these strings here? Do you want to have a go? Yeah. Okay, come over here. Come around this side. There we go. That's, you hang on to that there. Now, what we're going to do is I'll come down here with this. Now, everybody pulls on the string. You pull on the string, pull on the string, pull it. Now let it go. See there, you can hold it. All right. So let's go there. You hang on to this, Lachlan. Is that right?
That's me, right.
Eli,
I've dressed my kids the same.
Okay, cool. All right, why don't I put it down there? Now let's see if you can lower that and put it down. Pull the string, that's it. Pull. Come down. Okay, now see if you can put it up on the table. Bring it over. Come on. This way. Okay, now you need to pull it again so you can pull this rubber band out and then lift it up. Hey! That wasn't too bad, was it? That's one. Do you reckon you can do two? Down you come. Over the cup. Oh, excellent. Now you've got to put it next to this one. Keep coming. That's it. You can move. You don't have to stay with... Okay. Now, all pull it out and let it sit there. Pull it out. Oh. Okay. Now, I might just... Same principle again. Here we go. Work together. That's it. All pulling. Oh, you guys are doing fantastic. Okay. Now, we have to put it next just here. Up on the table. Up. That's it. I think Mum's doing a good job. Oh, careful. Let's move it back this way. Oh. Two more to go. Now this time, that's it. Down. Oh, you're concentrating. Mm-hmm. That's it. Pull it out. Wow. Now this time it's got to come up onto here. Do you reckon you can put it up where my finger is? Up there, that's it. Over, 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 over. Pull it all out. Now lift it up. Oh, excellent. Last time. Whoa. It's got a step. Thank you. Thank you, Eli. That's it. Oh, now you guys are doing it. You're working out what you've got to do. It's got to come over to this one. Oh, this is going to be tricky. Let's see. Okay, so there we go. You can pull. Here we are. Oh, no. Let it go. Wow. Oh, now that deserves a round of applause, doesn't it? Thank you, guys. Do you reckon you could have done this on your own? Because you've only got two hands, haven't you? So, and even if you pulled it that way, so it needs to have a cooperation of all different, four different people, and mum and the minister helping as well. If we had more time, I reckon you guys could work it out that you'd do it great. Well, thanks for doing that. That's excellent. But why do we do that? What might that tell us? Well, it tells us that when we want to do something, sometimes we need more than just ourselves. We need some help. And that's why we've got mums and dads and friends and teachers and family and church that can all help us to learn how to do things right. It's important for us to know that we don't have to do it all on our own. And there's someone else that can help us do stuff. Of course, we know that God and Jesus, God's Son, they are always by our side helping us to do stuff. We can't see them like you can see Elijah or William or Mum or me, but we know that Jesus is always with us. And if we ask and if we trust and we kind of think, oh, maybe God could help me be better, then God will. But we have to ask and we have to trust or believe. So maybe let's think about when we want to do something and we're struggling because we can't quite get it right, we can ask our friends or our family or our mum or our dad, anybody else. And sometimes that's good. And also it's good for us to maybe say a prayer, because that's talking to God, talking to Jesus, and just say, Jesus, help me. And if we believe, then Jesus can. Does that make sense? Yeah. Thanks, guys. You've been a great help. The second one spoke about, well, what if God doesn't deliver me from disaster? The third one today, this is actually a bit more positive. It says, what if victory does come through faith and prayer? So there's another modern song group that are going to bring to us a video. Let's pause and reflect upon these words.
Everybody falls sometimes. Gotta find the strength to rise from the ashes and make a new beginning. Anyone can feel the ache. You think it's more than you can take, but you're stronger, stronger than you know. Don't you give up now, the sun will soon be shining. You gotta face the clouds to find the silver lining. I've seen dreams that move the mountains. Hope that doesn't ever end, even when the sky is falling. I've seen miracles just happen. Silent prayers get answered. Broken hearts become brand new. That's what faith can do. It doesn't matter what Impossible's not a word. It's just a reason for someone not to try. Everybody's scared to death when they decide to take that step out on the water. But it'll be alright. Life is so much more than what your eyes are seeing. You will find your way if you keep believing. I've seen dreams that move the mountains. Hope that doesn't ever end, even when the sky.
First, we have Psalm 18. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God, my rock, in whom I take refuge. My shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and shall be saved from my enemies. The cords of death encompassed me, the torments of perdition assailed me. The cords of Sheol entangled me, the snares of death confronted me. In my distress I called upon the Lord, to my God I cried for help. From his temple he heard my voice, and my cry to him reached his ears. Then we have John chapter 5, verses 1 to 5. Faith conquers the world. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the parent loves the child. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and obey his commandments. For the love of God is this, the way we obey his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome, for whatever is born of God conquers the world. And this is the victory that conquers the world, our faith. Who is it that conquers the world but the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? And the second reading is from Matthew chapter 7 verses 7 to 12. Ask not, ask, search, knock. Ask and it will be given you, search and you will find, knock and the door will be opened for you. For everyone who asks receives, and everyone who searches finds, and for everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Is there anyone among you who, if your child asks for bread, will give a stone? Or if the child asks for a fish, will give a snake? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good things to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good things to those who ask him? In everything, do to others as you would have them do to you, for this is the law and the prophets. Thanks be God. This is the gospel of the Lord. Sorry.
Thanks, Rosemarie, for bringing to us those words from the scriptures. Those promises from the Bible are encouraging, are supportive, and in those times when we feel low, or as the song said, when we've fallen or when we're at our lowest, it's good to know that God does care, that God does answer prayers, and that God does give good things to God's children. It's good for us to remember that, and we also look in reality and recognise that we don't get all that we ask for. Those words from Matthew talk about asking and seeking and knocking, and there's a sense of desire for coming to God and placing our concerns in front of God, and God hearing us, and through the grace of Jesus Christ, our prayers are answered. The reality is that we know that that doesn't happen all the time. It would maybe be a different question if, instead of standing and sharing around the church like we did a moment ago, something to be thankful this week, maybe if we ask the question, when was the last time you prayed and God answered in a way in which you anticipated or expected? When was the last time you knocked at the door and it was opened? When was the last time you sought something and you found it? When was the last time you asked God and you received? Would you be able to recall last week, or the week before, or 2 months ago, or 1975? The reality is that sometimes we find a disengagement with that sense of the Bible promises and God answering our prayers. The Bible does teach us that God hears, that God cares. It's not just the psalmist. We find that even today there are people who speak of their prayer coming to God and praying earnestly, and miracles happen. The song reminds us that miracles do happen. Silent prayers are answered. One of the things about that word miracle is that to be a miracle, it means that it doesn't happen often. It means that it's almost impossible. And yet, at this point of time, at this moment, because of someone's faith and their trust in God and God's movement in their lives, something happened which was unexpected. We, through our community or through our own families, may have come to God with a specific request, particularly over a health issue, when someone or ourselves might have been struggling, and we pray and we pray and we pray and nothing seems to change. In fact, things get worse. And yet we hear that sometimes our friends or other churchgoers or someone in another church or someone that we've seen from a word of a friend of a friend of a friend, we find that they have prayed and they have come before God, and suddenly the cancer has gone, or the person has been made well, or somehow the circumstances, financial or relationship, they've all been healed and everything goes on as if you can prove that God was present. How do we hold all that together? I know that there was some sincere Port people on Friday night who were earnestly begging God for a victory. And maybe we just have to say that there were more Christians concerned in the Richmond team that God answered their prayer? Is that the way that God works? Is it a sort of, you know, who gets the biggest number, who gets the right words, who has the magic charms that makes it all happen? Our faith tells us, history tells us, the gospel shows to us that it's not about that. Our prayers are heard by God, and God does answer our prayers. Probably that's why I brought this one in as number three, so that we could reflect upon the theology of what happens when we pray and the struggles continue. It seems to us that on the week one, when we ask and seek God, when we pray for God's help and blessing and things get worse or it just continues, there is no change, the scriptures remind us that there is something to be learnt, that there are blessings even in the midst of the struggle, even if the journey that takes night after night after night after night, and we struggle and we lie there calling out to God and nothing seems to change, we find that somehow our prayer and our faith affects us. It's not a matter of going to God and just wearing God down that eventually he'll give in and give us what we want. It's that prayer and that faith that we sustain our trust and our faith in God. We hope for an answer. And in the midst of the confusion and the isolation and the struggle and the darkness, we can still know that God is with us. Remember Psalm 23? Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. These are not words just to make you feel good. These are not words just so that you'll keep on enduring. These are words that are speak of the reality that faith and prayer endures and encourages us in our relationship with God. It's not a matter of ticking the boxes to see, yes, I got what I wanted. Thank you, God. Everything's okay now. It's in the midst of the struggle that we find that we can know God all the more better, closer, more intimate in our connection with God. The second week we talked about, well, what happens if God doesn't save me from disaster? The story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Yes, our God will save us from the fire, but even if he doesn't, we will still trust in our God and not follow you, O mighty King. The story ended happily. They were saved. They did get into the Bible. And then we reflected on the story of Stephen, who, in the midst of his declaration of his faith in Jesus, was stoned by the crowd. And he prayed for their forgiveness. He prayed to God. He saw Jesus in the heavens as a vision as he died. Did God answer his prayer? And we know that that was the powder keg, that spark that set off all that persecution of the early church. Many suffered. Was God not hearing their prayers? And yet we know that that event caused the Christians to scatter, and so the gospel moved into communities that would not have heard of the truth of Jesus, nor the impact and the passion and the power of their faith had everything been easy. One of the struggles that many Christian countries, and Australia still kind of is a Christian country, its heritage is Christian. It's interesting there that in these communities, in our communities, where people have not been tortured or pressured or blamed for their faith for so long that, yeah, the numbers in our churches are not as full as in some places where they are still persecuted for their faith. Something about the struggle seems to intensify our need to know God. So faith and prayer does lead to God answering our prayers, does lead to God's blessings, does lead to opportunities for miracles to happen, but not always the way in which we expect. Prayer and faith affect us more than God. It gives us a focus, a shifting of what's important. It encourages us in our patience and it enables us to be empathetic. People who always get what they ask for, people who always have the money or the circumstances or the charisma or just the opportunity to get their needs satisfied readily and easily, tend not to be empathetic. They tend not to understand what other people are going through. God is more interested in us developing as good people rather than as people with everything that we desire. Faith and prayer does lead to victory, does lead to answered prayer. But on the journey, we find that the prayer at the beginning may not be the same as the prayer at the end. The way in which it's answered may encourage us to see that God is still with us and that God has something more for us to learn. Prayer and faith enables us to be hopeful. And hope is a strong word. Sometimes it can be mediated down to be a little bit wishy-washy, or, you know, you just sort of hope that something, a bit like a dream or a wish, or just, maybe I hope it happens. I hope you'll be okay. The hope that our faith and prayers develop is a hope that recognises that there is an end and it is a good end. That life continues and that life is full of blessing. That hope is strong and enduring and it's encouraging and it's infectious. It enables other people to rise and to continue on, to find that there is more than what we would see, there more than what other people would expect. We don't have to be on a comparison list and say that the best Christian is the one who has the most prayers answered. Remember when you used to have a black leather Bible and you'd have little marks down the bottom on every time, you know, you made a conversion or every time God answered your prayer, and the one at the end with the most gold scribes around the edge of the Bible, they're obviously a holy or a sainted person. We know that that's not true. We know that that's not true. So in our journey, wherever we are in our journey, wherever you are, you may have a deep felt prayer that you've brought to God for years. You may just have something that's happened in your life in the last few months. It needs to settle. It needs to be real and purposeful in your life. And you bring it to God with faith and trust that God will answer your prayer. Because the other thing is, we all get worn. You know, like erosion, the wind and the sand, it sort of wears away the edges. Some of us get to a point where we don't ask God because we've been disappointed so many times before. And it's easier not to be hopeful. It's easier not to expect that things will be different. It's easier to say, well, this is our lot and we will just ask God for grace to endure and to bear it. That's easier than asking for something and being let down. Is that our experience of God? God encourages us not just to endure the struggles of life, but God encourages us to stand and to look forward to the possibilities and to be ever seeking and asking and knocking that things will be different, that there is goodness and that our lives can change. I said before, often our prayers and in our journey in seeking God, it has little to do with impacting God. It has more to do with changing us. So may we have faith. May we trust in God, and may that build and strengthen and nurture and challenge us that maybe sometimes for the answer of our prayer, we've got to get up out of the pew and we've got to step a few steps. Like Peter, we've got to get out of the boat, hoping and trusting that God will answer our prayers, even if it's been a long time since he's done that. Maybe there's a challenge for us to hold on to the possibilities that God will change things in our lives, in our families, in our friends, in our community, in our church. Our hope is founded on God. Our hope is built in God's presence, God's deliverance. If it's been a long time since you've prayed and had an answer from God, don't give up. Continue, trust, and allow this journey to impact and change your life and make you ready for the answer that God has for you. We continue in worship by singing TIS 560. The words will be on the screen. Please remain seated and reflect on the words and renew your own assurance that God hears your prayers and that God has an answer for you.
What a wonderful set of words. Yeah. God blesses us with so many of the hymns we sing and have a chance to reflect on them. I omitted, although now I realise I intended, to tell you about the new times available as you leave church this morning. This gives us an opportunity to think about, as we read month by month, it's six times a year now, but it's full of stories about the church at large. This issue reflects on the interesting development of how our church now has three presbyteries, and something of the story of each presbytery is told. We belong to the Adelaide South, something like that. The Southern South Australia, a presbytery. There's a Northern Western Presbytery, it's got a beautiful name, it's called Wimala, I think, an indigenous name. And then there's the other presbytery called Generate, which is picks up the notion that congregations generate life together. So that story's there. But behind that, there's so often the stories of the way the church has reached out with the people's own personal gifts, but then also with their monetary gifts to enable the wider mission of the church to the community and the world to go on. So that's what our gifts are always for, week by week when we bring them. You've either put them in the offering box as you came in this morning or as you go out. Let's seek that God will bless those gifts now. Let us pray. By your grace, you have enabled us to have a livelihood that has given us resources. For many of us, they are enough. And they are enough to share. And so we bring this morning gifts from our hearts and our lives, monetary gifts to be used and blessed in the service of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In the prayers for the people this morning, I want to do two things. Firstly, we will have a brief time when we will pray in our own hearts for members of family, friends, people we've heard about, who we would want to bring to God now to be blessed in their circumstance. Now, the COVID experience around the world is dramatic, stressful, and sad in so many ways. But by God's grace and the gift and skill of science, there's a recovery that is appearing, but it shows that it can have cycles. And so there may be someone in your family who lives in Victoria, and they've known lots of stress. You may have family that lives in the UK, in Europe. You may have someone who lives in America. You may have someone who lives in India, in Southern Asia. Right around the world, you may know of people. And now in a moment of silence, half a minute, you'll think of them and you'll offer them to God. So let us pray. Lord, hear our prayers for your name's sake. Now, the second part of our praying at this point as people of God, because the world is in an experience of stress, sometimes it's two things can happen. We can pray for all the good things that God enables to happen, and we never read about them, or rarely, and wonderful things do happen, and we give thanks for them. But the world persists through history to be at war. There's little peace. And so this morning now, I want to take you through a litany for world peace from Uniting in Worship. And at points I'll invite you to make the response with me, O Lord, deliver us. That would be the words, O Lord, deliver us. Let us pray. From the curse of war and the human sin that causes war, O Lord, deliver us. From pride that turns its back on you, and from unbelief that will not call you Lord, O Lord, deliver us. From national vanity that poses as patriotism, from loud-mouthed boasting, the blind self-worship that admits no guilt, from the self-righteousness that will not compromise, and from selfishness that gains by the oppression of others, O Lord, deliver us. For the lust for money or power that drives people to kill, from trusting in the weapons of war and mistrusting the counsels of peace, O Lord, deliver us. From hearing and believing propaganda and speaking lies about other nations, from groundless suspicions and fears that stand in the way of reconciliation, O Lord, deliver us. From words and deeds that encourage discord, prejudice and hatred, from everything that prevents the human family from fulfilling your promise of peace, O Lord, deliver us. O God, our Father, we pray for all your children on this earth, of every nation and every race, and by your grace, bring not only peace to the nations, but peace in their individual lives. And bless us that we may be strong to do your will for this purpose. In the name of Jesus, amen. And now our Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
magic words. There's no formula that can instantly transform your life. So wherever you are on your journey in your faith and trust in Jesus, wherever you are in your prayers and the answers that you receive, may you continue to hold dearly onto God. May you allow God to transform and encourage you. May your life and your actions continue to bring hope to others, even in the midst of darkness and despair. Let us trust in God. Let us go through our life knowing that God goes with us and that God's blessing is in our hearts and in our lives. So go in God's name. Be people of faith and prayer and hope. Bless us each one. Go in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.